Welcome to GTN's Coach's Corner, where we're going to be answering all your triathlon-related questions. You can submit them to us using the hashtag GTN's Coach's Corner, and you can submit them on YouTube and our social media platforms. Now, with racing, hopefully, commencing around the world or in many parts of the world, we've been noticing that many of you have been hard in training and you've been submitting race-related questions to us. So we thought we'd start up this Coach's Corner. We'd be putting out this video once every 2 weeks and basically providing a resource to you and helping you along and through that journey. And what I've got to say, there does seem to be a bit of a theme with many of these questions of late regarding getting back into swimming, increasing training, and of course, getting ready for racing. So let's get stuck in with the first question. Mitchell Atkins said, I want to know how to get my hips up and higher, closer to the surface of the water. Do I need to arch my back or something? Well, good question. It's a big question. You're definitely not alone. To answer your first question, no, you certainly should not be arching your back. You want to have a good, strong core. As soon as you start letting that core go, you're essentially losing that stiffness in your body and the ability to apply as much power as you possibly can. Now, to explain to people out there that aren't aware already, the reason why you want to get your hips and your legs close to the surface of the water is to reduce essentially your frontal area through the water. Now, if I'm coming towards you at the camera, if my hips and legs were dropped, you can see that my frontal area is increased. So I'm almost dragging a plow through the water. As soon as you lift your hips and legs up, you're reducing that frontal area, more streamlined through the water, and therefore reducing the amount of effort you need to get yourself through the water. Now, there's a few reasons that your hips and legs may be dropping. Could be that you're looking ahead while swimming. So whilst you're swimming, you're looking up. That's going to force your hips and legs to drop because your body almost acts a bit like a seesaw. So lift your head up, your hips and legs are going to drop. Could be that you're lifting your head to breathe. So each time you breathe, you lift your head out of the water. So similarly, you get that seesaw effect because you're lifting that big weight, your head, up out of the water, hips and legs drop. Also, this might sound odd, but it could be because you're holding your breath. But if you think about it, you're storing a load of air in your lungs, which is rather buoyant. And again, you get that seesaw effect because your chest is raising up in the water, then your hips and legs will drop down. Also, as a result, it can actually create tension in your upper body. Because you're holding on to your breath, that's going to limit the amount of movement, which again, it's going to lead me on to the next one, is reduces your catch or your ability to catch and apply water, apply force at the front of the stroke. Now, if you think about it, if you think of almost like your hips or your torso as the pivot point of your body, if you can apply force at the front of the stroke, it's going to help to lift the legs up. Now, if you can't apply that force, then the back end of your body is going to start to drop down. So you want to work out which one is the cause for your hips and legs dropping and then address that. And we've got a ton of videos over on our channel which do address sinking legs, sinking hips, and trying to improve that. So go check those ones out. Sticking with swimming, Jamie Furman has asked, what is the difference between a 2, a 4, and a 6 beat kick, and how can I tell which you have? Which is another good question. Well, simply, they are the difference in speed or kick rate. So 2 being a slow kick, 6 or an 8 being a nice fast leg kick. So this is measured over a full left and right arm cycle. So a 2 beat kick would be 1 kick on, say, the left arm and then 1 kick on the right arm, making it 2 kicks throughout the whole stroke. A 4 beat kick is 2 kicks per arm, 6 beat kick, 3 kicks per arm, and so on. You get the picture. That's really it. In terms of figuring out for yourself, well, this is actually quite tricky because as you may have found out already, when you start trying to count the number of kicks when you swim, you actually can subconsciously affect how you're kicking because you're trying to count at the same time. But what I would say is for a 2 beat kick, it's pretty obvious because it is 1 kick per stroke. between a 4 and 6 week kicker can be quite tricky. If you can find someone to count for you, or better, record you, film you, then you can figure out. Okay, now moving on to a question that I'm sure many of you had over this past year, and well, maybe even this year too. Unfortunately, what should I do if my race has been postponed? And this one comes in from Rob Brydon, hopefully the actor. I mean, you've gone under the radar a bit if you've taken up triathlon, Rob Brydon. Anyway, he's followed on to say, should I continue to train hard or should I rejig my schedule? Well, I think firstly, we could be here all day answering this one. That probably does deserve its own dedicated video. It is, of course, so personal. When has the race been postponed to? Is it in simply a month's time, or is it later this year in 4 or 5 months' time? And also, what shape are you currently in? Have you managed to get yourself in peak shape, or were you way off that anyway? Now, first of all, talking about that peak shape, once you get yourself into peak shape, it's worth pointing out that you can't just sustain that indefinitely. You will eventually plateau, and potentially, if you keep pushing at that kind of level, you're going to overtrain and drop off a cliff, which nobody wants to do, and you can end up in a bit of a deep dark hole. So initially, if you have got yourself in really good shape, you do want to back off, regardless of whether it's in a month's time or 5 months' time. If it's in a month's time, you're just backing off a little bit, and then you can push on again, just going into the race. If it's later this year, you may even want to think about going as far as taking a mini break. Now, this isn't uncommon. A lot of pros do this in the middle of a long season. You may just want to take a week off or a couple of weeks off, and that's to recharge physically, but also mentally. It's a long time to be dragging out your training in a season for. And also, if you've got a family, a partner, it could be a good time to just give back to them a little bit. I imagine you've probably made quite a lot of sacrifices to do all this training, and it might just be nice to spend a bit of time with them, get them on side before pushing back on. In terms of your workouts and your sessions, again, this is so personal, but what I've done in the past for athletes, regardless of COVID, just when they've had to rejig schedules, stripping out some of that race-specific sweet spot threshold work that can be really quite taxing and stressful on the body, and just going back to some of the more strength-based stuff, the zone 3 stuff, but also complementing it with some of the high-intensity stuff, but really short duration. So just making sure we're hitting both ends of the spectrum. The threshold sweet spot stuff is fantastic for getting you fit, but it's not the sort of workouts and efforts that you should be doing indefinitely. So hold on to those until closer to the race. As I said, this is a huge topic. We can go on about this for days. But if you do have any other specific questions, drop them in the comment section below using that hashtag GTN Coaches Corner, and we can maybe delve into it a little bit more next week. Next question, this one comes from Her Daniel. He has asked, or she has asked, is it worth it to buy a TT or tri bike as my second bike? I don't actually compete in time trials or triathlons, but they do look cool and fun. Damn right they do. I've heard about how they're horribly suited to normal road riding, but I was wondering if I could still have some fun out on it, even on a solo ride. Well, first of all, the fact you just want to get a TT or triathlon bike, you don't even do triathlon, get going on you. And hopefully we can convince you then to do triathlon or TTs. First of all, I would say if you're just kind of interested in this whole going fast on a bike, and or maybe if you are a triathlete and you're wanting to upgrade a little bit, make sure you've explored the clip-on aero bar option first, so you can add those onto your normal road bike. One bit of advice, if you are doing that, push the seat or the saddle up a little bit and forwards, because a road bike at the end of the day wasn't really designed to have clip-on aero bars on. So just whacking the clip-on aero bars on and staying in normal position, it's going to be a bit uncomfortable. So you need to adapt the bike a little bit, because it has got a slightly slacker seat tube angle. So a good way of doing that is just butting the saddle up and forwards a tiny bit. And then, yeah, if you've explored that and you feel like you've got as much out of that as you possibly can, then go down the triathlon bike or TT bike route. Yeah, they are super fun. Admittedly, they can be a little less comfortable than a road bike, but you equally can get yourself very comfortable on them. They take a little bit of getting used to adapting. At the end of the day, you are down on the aero bars, and if you want to get to the brakes, you've got to be moving around. So yeah, worth bearing in mind, but explore that road bike with clip-on aero bars option first. Next question from HH65Flyer. Maybe an explanation is needed of the different positions and use of the big end versus the small end. And they're referring to a pool boy here, in case you're wondering. Now, this is an interesting one. And from what I understand and have been told in the past, is the big end essentially goes the lowest in the water. So for instance, if I'm swimming front crawl on my front, the big end would go around the front. So it would be the deepest in the water. And that then means that my legs are nicely gripped onto the pool boy. The pool boy is not going to slip out as easily, and with the smallest end kind of poking out the top. The only issue that does come with that is when you go to do tumble turns and you've got this bigger thing as you're crunching up into a ball. I won't go into the details. But anyway, I mean, that is what I've been led to believe. I'd love to hear anyone else's evidence or explanation on this. So if you do know, get involved in the comment section down below. But yeah, big end, deepest in the water, best grip, and good buoyancy. Next question from The Car Dude. Might be a silly question. Nothing's a silly question. But would you include both uphill and downhill fast sets in your hill reps, or just hard going uphill and gentle coming down? Firstly, uphill efforts, fantastic. Downhill efforts, we've done a whole video on this. I would be very careful with. They're something that you want to build up to gradually with time. Understandably, you're putting a bit more stress and impact through your lower limbs when you're running fast downhill. It's something that I have done in my training. I wouldn't say I necessarily go hell for leather downhills, but it can help for increasing that turnover of your legs. So if you're doing hill reps, I probably just suggest focusing on doing hard efforts on those hill reps and then just jogging, walking back down. Of course, feel free to, in other sessions, work on just letting yourself go, getting used to running faster downhills, but I wouldn't necessarily suggest going hell for leather downhills all the time. Just, yeah, be careful of that. YY has asked, if you only have or are able to display full fields of data on your bike computer during a ride, what would it be? What do you think are the most useful four data bits to constantly look at? Personally speaking, four probably won't be enough, but I'll try. I'd have normalized power, and that would just be the current power, maybe an average of 3 seconds, something like that. I normally have my lap time. I potentially have my heart rate, although I've got to say I'm pretty bad at using heart rate. I don't always use that all the time. And then maybe speed, again, maybe not as important. I probably actually substitute that more for average lap power, or average normalized lap power. Therefore, when I'm doing reps, I sort of know how I'm doing across the board of that whole, say, 10-minute effort. Yeah, personally speaking, they're kind of the ones that I look to the most. Heart rate, if I used it more, I'd probably definitely say that's one that you would keep. So yeah, hopefully that's helped. And now for the final question from Ben Quinn, and they've asked, what does turning around on 2 minutes mean? Now, again, this is a really simple question, but it certainly isn't a silly question either. I'm sure many people out there have the same question, maybe too scared to ask. Now, this is relevant for all sports, but it's particularly used in swimming. You'd often hear people saying, right, you've got a turnaround time of 2 minutes or turnaround time of 3 minutes. What it means is that from the moment of leaving the wall, you have 2 minutes to complete that rep and then leave for the next rep. So you might complete that first rep in 1 minute and 30 seconds, and then you've got 30 seconds of rest, which is static at the wall, before then leaving for the next rep. So a turnaround time of 2 minutes. I think that's the best way to explain it. I don't know how else I can explain that without overcomplicating it. Anyway, I hope you have enjoyed today's video. Please do give it a thumbs up, give it a like. Please get involved in the comment section down below. Leave your questions for next week, perhaps maybe more on that postponement of races, which unfortunately I'm sure is going to come this year. And don't forget to use that hashtag GTN Coaches Corner. If you're not doing so already, make sure you're giving us a follow over on social media and give us a subscribe just down below.